وينشر الهدي إيمانا وموعظة فبالجهالة قد خابت مساعينا خابت مناقبنا واسود حاضرنا خابت مناقبنا واسود حاضرنا وأوشك اليأس أن يغشى.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. Welcome to another edition of the Sulaimaan Ravat Show. Yes, another beautiful Friday evening. Another week has lapsed. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala accept our humble efforts in the week that has lapsed. And may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala forgive our deficiencies. May every week in our lives be better than the week that has gone by. And may every day in our lives be better than the day that has gone by. I think it was Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu used to say that, I consider my day to have been a failure if that day did not bring me closer to Allah than what I was. Subhanallah, what a benchmark and what a standard to which Sahaba held themselves. That, if the day that passed is not better than the day, if today is not better than the day that passed, then I consider it a day wherein I've wasted my time. I consider it a day wherein I did not, achieve anything. So, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us that understanding, and may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala make our life such that every day is better than the day that precedes it, and every night is better than the night that precedes it. Yes, Muharram is about to leave us now, and last week we started that story on the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And we spoke at length about why Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala makes mention of stories in the Quran Kareem. It's not in chronological order, as explained. It's not in sequence. It's because Allah wants to highlight various lessons at various points. And accordingly, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala brings in aspects of the story. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam's story is the most mentioned story in the Quran Kareem. Also, what we learn is that 136 times reference is made to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam in the Quran, and the most mentioned prophet. Many parallels between what this ummah has to go through and what the ummah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had to go through. All things considered, all said and done, as they say. In the end of the day, we have to take lessons from it. That's the main thing. The entire Surah Yusuf is revealed, the one surah of the Quran where there is some sequence and it's mentioned from beginning to end. And in the last verse, what does Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala say? لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. These stories are not there for the sake of fairy tales. These stories are there for you to take lesson. And it's the people of intelligence that will take lesson. I mentioned normally that when we did the tafsir of Surah Yusuf, then our ustad told us that you see, most people when they read Surah Yusuf, they romanticize the whole story. So when they finish, they want to know, did Yusuf marry Zulaikha? As if that's the most relevant point, or that's the big lesson to be derived from whether he married or he didn't marry her. There's so many other lessons, more pivotal, more important, primary lessons that are to be derived from the story of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions, and this is the barakah in the Quran, that there's always lesson, and every scholar and every author will take out a different lesson, and will take out a different pearl and a different gem and a different perspective. And that's how you improve, and that's how you increase. So we discussed last week the verses pertaining to when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam received Nubuwwah, and how the Quran Kareem tells a story, how Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala makes mention of it, and the different lessons we learn from it, and how Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala paints the scene. It is almost as if the Quran takes you there. That's the manner and the method in which the Quran Kareem paints a picture and tells a story. And then the second part is we focused on the dua of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Where we learn so many leadership lessons. First and foremost, you turn to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. The more you achieve in life, and this was the ultimate achievement to become a Nabi, the ultimate honor and privilege, the more the need for you to turn to Allah. The more you need Allah. Only Allah can help you, no matter how high up you are. Then, وَحْلُ الْأُقْدَةَ مِّن لِسَانِي, remove the stutter from my tongue. It shows a man who's in tune with his limitations, and a great Nabi is more in tune, a great leader is more in tune with his limitations as compared to his strengths. Yafqahu qawli shows you intention, that he didn't want the knot to be returned, to be untied from his tongue, so that he could be known as a prolific orator. No, so that the message could be communicated. The job must get done. It's not about titles, it's not about fame. Then the greatest lesson of empowerment, the greatest dua that one brother made for the next, وَجَعَلِّي وَزِيرًا مِّنْ أَهْلِ هَارُونَ أَخِي أُشْتُدْ بِهِ أَزْرِي وَأَشْرِكْهُ فِي أَمْرِي. That, oh Allah, grant me my brother Harun as a companion, as a partner in Nubuwa. He's asking Allah that I don't want to enjoy this alone. I have certain skills, or I don't have certain skills, and he has it. Let him also be privileged with the same honor. Let us share in the honor, but let us then tackle the job together and be more effective in fulfilling the mission. And we spoke about delegation. We spoke about empowerment, how great leaders don't create many followers, but great leaders create other leaders. How Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tutored Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and other many great Sahaba, and how they in turn tutored people, and that's how Islam prospered, and that's how we learn, and that's how we achieve and we excel in life. So those are some of the aspects that we touched on last week. Just to wrap up on that aspect of leadership, you know, from the dua of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, one is a leader and the other is a ruler. Just to understand some of the differences, a leader is one that emerges from people. A ruler campaigns amongst people. A leader, because of his conduct, because of his demeanor, because of his mannerisms, he'll just emerge from amongst people. You can just recognize that that's a leader. A ruler, he'll need to go and campaign. Vote for me because of X, Y, and Z. I'm not saying that campaigning sometimes is not permissible. I know Yusuf alayhi salam, in a way you could say campaigned. He went to the king and he said, Inni hafidun alim. I have the two requisites here. I am trustworthy and I am knowledgeable. You can trust me and I can do the job. Yes, sometimes when there's a need for you to do it, yeah, you can understand. But generally, a leader emerges. A leader derives his appeal from humility. A ruler derives his appeal from superiority. A leader's hallmark is mercy. Oh, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was always worried about every ummati of his, even those who were not accepting his message. Azizun alayhi ma anittum. That whatever you go through, it weighs very heavily on him. Harisun alaykum. He's always very worried about you. And that's the whole ummah, Muslims and non-Muslims. Bil mu'mineen, when it comes to believers, then he's especially compassionate and merciful. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would worry about not only the spiritual, more so the spiritual condition of the people, but even the physical condition. A leader shows undying concern. A ruler demands unyielding compliance. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would walk with the widows. He would look after the orphans. He would see to the needs of the poor. A leader is reliable. A ruler is reliant. A leader elects people of expertise. A ruler elects people for expediency. They call it cadre deployment, or they call it factionalism. You appoint people into positions who you know are going to be loyal to, are going to serve your interests, not the people who can do the job. It's a big problem today. That's why we have rulers today. We don't have leaders. A leader is free from greed. A ruler thrives on greed. It's the greed for wealth and more so the greed for power. See, today some mayors, they earn more than what the president earns. Some mayors, they earn more than what the president earns. But why do you want to become president as compared to a mayor? Because when you become president, then you are able to wield more power. You can put in place a system of patronage. Your official salary may be one thing, but what you get unofficial is another thing. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not a ruler. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a leader. And you know, these leadership lessons, they are not only for people who are in politics. So they're not only for people who are in the corporate world. No. These lessons are for all of us. We are leaders in our classrooms. We are leaders in our small shops. We are leaders in our homes as parents. We are leaders amongst our colleagues when we have certain responsibilities, project management. So let's keep in mind these lessons that we learn from the lives of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. We go for a break. When we come back, we move on to the third portion of what I want to discuss from the lives of Musa alayhi salam, and that's some contemporary, or rather lessons that have a contemporary relevance where we can take from the story of Musa alayhi salam and see how those lessons can assist us in our individual and collective contemporary challenges.
كاليأس أن يغشى أمانينا فبالجهاد بنى الإسلام قوته.
Okay, welcome back. Now, I want to discuss some lessons from the life of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, which are relevant to our contemporary challenges. The first is, after Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala had sent Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and his brother Harun, now they are being sent to a tyrant. A tyrant whose tyranny and whose oppression is in many ways unparalleled. And thirdly, this is a tyrant who claims nubuwa, or who claims divinity, not even nubuwa, who claims divinity, who claims to be Allah. Yet Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says to Musa and Harun alayhim as-salatu wasalam, فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. Speak to him in a soft way, in a nice way, in a diplomatic way, in a compassionate way. لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَى. So that, you know, he may take lesson, he may start realizing, he may start becoming fearful of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. You know, one day a person came to Harun Rashid, and Harun Rashid was the Khalifa, and this person was unhappy, probably something pertaining to service delivery, and he let rip, as we would say. He let Harun Rashid have it. So Harun Rashid said to him, listen, what you say or what you said, whether it's valid or not, that's on its place, right? But your tone, your approach, your manner, when Allah sent Musa and Harun alayhi salam to Fir'aun, Allah said, speak to him nicely. You are not better than Musa and Harun, and I am not worse than Fir'aun. So talk to me nicely. Now, it's a great lesson in da'wah. You know, sometimes we speak to people in a very condescending way. Sometimes we speak to people in a top-down way, almost like with a kind of superiority complex, that we know it all. What do you know? Sometimes if a person is wrong, we are very harsh. We want to bludgeon that person into submission. We want to sledgehammer that person into understanding. But it doesn't work like that in life. In real life, it just does not work like that. You need to take time. You need to be compassionate. You need to be merciful. Look at how the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam used to be accused of different things. You are ignorant. You're a fool. Ya qawmi laysa bi dalala. Ya qawmi laysa bi safaha. أَنَا لَكُمْ نَاصِحٌ أَمِينٌ أَنْصَحُ لَكُمْ وَأَعْلَمُ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. The words were always soft. The words were always diplomatic. The words were always underpinned by compassion, by kindness, by understanding, by feeling. And that is the lesson we must learn from the life of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. When you want to alert somebody to something wrong that they have done, when you want to make them realize that what they have done is not the best or it's not appropriate, The way to do that is actually to use nice words, to use kind words, to use soft words, to be diplomatic. Today we don't know how to speak, even to non-Muslims. We want to come across with the superiority complex, harsh. You know, our deen is truth, so we'll just tell you the truth. It doesn't have to be that way. You follow the sunnah of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam and see what difference it will make. The second lesson that we can learn from the life of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, which has great contemporary relevance, is that when the oppression of Pharaoh was at its might, and remember one thing about dictators, when the oppression is at the worst, that's when they're starting to weaken. That's when their grip on power is starting to lessen. Where do we get this from? I'll tell you where we get this from. See, when a tyrant is in control, when a tyrant is feeling relatively secure, they don't need to do drastic things. But once they still start feeling like they're losing control, once they start feeling like the control is slipping from their hands, that's the time. That's the time they start doing drastic things. When Pharaoh felt it was slipping, that's when he started slaughtering boys. Illogical, even by his standards of intelligence. When Musa alayhi salam defeated the magicians, that's when all hell broke loose. And even his ministers could now goad him. And because they themselves were becoming paranoid. وَقَالَ الْمَلَأُ مِنْ قَوْمِ فِرْعَوْنَ. From amongst these people, the high-ranking people said, أَتَذَرُ مُوسَى وَقَوْمَهُ لِيُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَيَذَرَكَ آلِهَتَكَ. Look at what they're doing. You can't allow for them to continue like this. So what did he say? سَنُقَتِّلُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. I'll kill the sons. وَنَسْتَحْيِ نِسَاءَهُمْ. And I let the women live. وَإِنَّ فَوْقَهُمْ قَاهِرُونَ. If you understand the Arabic language, oh, we are going to let them have it. They will know now who's in charge. What did Musa alayhi salatu wasalam say in the midst of all of this? Allah says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said to his people, إِسْتَعِينُوا بِاللَّهِ. seek assistance from Allah. Wasbiru, and persevere. Continue to do good, continue to abstain from evil, and when difficulties and hardships come, bear it with patience. That's the meaning of perseverance. Threefold, right? And before that, seek assistance from Allah. Continue to turn to Allah. Innal arda lillah, this land belongs to Allah. This land and whatever is in this land, it belongs to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Yurithuha man yasha'u min ibadih. Allah grants it to whomsoever He wants from His servants. وَلَعَقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. But if you have taqwa, if you have taqwa, then ultimately you prevail, ultimately you will succeed. Ultimately you will be the one who will get what you require. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ إِسْتَعِينُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاسْبِرُوا. Today the ummah feels engulfed. Today the ummah feels marginalized, oppressed, suppressed, and unjustifiably so. We know what's happening in various parts of the world. So difficult to even remember every area of conflict. إِسْتَعِينُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاسْبِرُوا. Persevere does not mean you become defeatist or you become passive. No, no. Whatever you need to do, you do it. But be steadfast on it. Be steadfast on whatever you need to do, and all the while, continue to seek assistance from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Continue to seek assistance from Allah. Because in the end, everything belongs to Allah. Everything is in the control of Allah. You need to draw from the treasures of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Once you've done that, then you secured. Now when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said that to the Banu Israel, they said, Udina min qabli an ta'tiyana wa min ba'di ma ji'tana. Hey Musa, we're getting a hiding. From before you came, we were getting a hiding from Pharaoh, and even after you came, we're still getting a hiding. And then he said, Asa rabbukum ayyuhliyakum ayyuhlika aduwakum wa yastakhlifakum fil ardi fayandura kayfa ta'amaloon. Listen, the tide has to turn. It won't be long before Allah will destroy your enemy, and you will then succeed them. And that's exactly what happened. If you look at the verses of Surah Dukhan, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mentions that Pharaoh, in his might and in his pomp and his glory, Musa alayhi salam and the Banu Israel were not interfering with him any longer. They fled, they left on the instruction of Allah. But no, like Abu Jahl could not leave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they pursued him in Hijrah and they pursued him in Badr. Here, Pharaoh goes and pursues them. He goes and pursues them. And when he pursues them, he meets his destruction. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala talks about what happens after he meets his destruction. Kam taraku min jannatin wa uyun. He leaves all of those gardens that he used to boast about, and all of those springs and all of those rivers. Kadhalika wa awrathnaha qawman akharin. Another nation came and inherited everything. The very Banu Israel that he was oppressing, they came and inherited everything. Fama bakat alayhim as-samaa wal-ard. Nobody in the heavens, nobody in the earth cried for him. Nobody. They say there's two doors in the heavens. Your good deeds go up and your sustenance comes down. And the day you die, both those doors close. And if you're a pious person, they cry because there's no functionality for them. Now, nobody cried for him. Those doors didn't cry. Nobody on planet Earth cried. No angel cried for him because he was a despicable human. Even though he had all the glory, even had all the wealth, all the power, all everything. But in the end, you rather have none of that, but have closeness. People must hold you close. The day you die, people will feel it. The day you die, people will cry for you. And crying for you meaning they will remember you and they will supplicate to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So the tide has to turn. Every Pharaoh has to meet his Moses. Even the Pharaohs of this time and age, they will meet their respective Moses, meaning there will be somebody or the other. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will create and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will send that will bring their dominion, and that will bring their oppression and their reign and their fiefdom to an end. Then the next lesson that I want to touch on, many times what happens is that we feel okay, but we're making dua and our dua is not getting accepted. So in terms of our individual difficulties or in terms of our collective difficulties, making dua, but my dua is not getting accepted by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Look here, we understand from the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam that for Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and Harun, the two brothers, they made da'wah. They called Pharaoh and his people for a number of years. And in those years, I mean, in those days, they used to live for very long periods, right? And then what happened is that they made dua to Allah, that, oh Allah, doesn't look like this man is going to change. Perhaps it's time now, oh Allah, that you destroy him. So Allah sends a revelation. قَدْ أُجِيبَتْ دَعْوَتُكُمَا. That, O Musa and Harun, I have accepted your supplication. Now, you and I, when we make dua, we have hope that the supplication would be accepted. We cannot have certainty that the supplication would be accepted. We have hope. Yet, Musa and Harun alayhi wasalam had certainty. How did they have certainty? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala told them via revelation that your dua has been accepted. Fastaqima, but continue to remain steadfast. And Pharaoh was only destroyed 40 years later. Pharaoh was destroyed 40 years later. They had to wait 40 years, which is almost like a lifetime for us, before Pharaoh was destroyed. So Allah works according to His own time frames. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala does not work according to our time frames. So we make dua. The hadith tells us, as a mercy from Allah, Allah will accept your dua, but in different forms. Maybe Allah will give you what you want immediately, or Allah will give you what you want at a later stage. Allah won't give you what you want, but He will avert the calamity or give you something else. Or nothing will come to you in this world, but you'll get it in the form of reward in the after. So whether it is individual difficulties or whether it is collective difficulties, never stop with the dua. Never give up with the dua. Let's continue and continue and continue, because at the bare minimum, or rather, even if the dua is not accepted as we understand acceptance in this world, we are going to get the reward in the after. And I've mentioned this many times in the Hadith al-Qudsi, we are told that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah, when He will show us the reward, we will feel that, oh Allah, You should not have accepted any of my du'as. You should put me through all of the difficulties so I could get so much of reward on the day of Qiyamah. Also, we should not lose hope. Musa alayhi salam never lost hope. He knew that the miracle would come from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. I alluded to this in the beginning part of the discussion last week. That look at this. I mean, Musa alayhi salam was born in the year when the children were slaughtered. Then he was thrown into the river Nile. Then he ate the coal. Then there was an arrest warrant on his head. Then he had to go to Midian. And really, if you had to look at it in the face of it, you would say, what a struggle, what a difficulty. There's no positive here. There's no light at the end of the tunnel. But then look at what happens. How Allah's plan plays out. That Pharaoh, that same Pharaoh who killed thousands of boys, he couldn't kill this one boy. This boy that he was supposed to kill ended up being nurtured in his own palace. That's the system of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. These tyrants, they cannot outsmart Allah. They cannot outdo Allah. They cannot overpower Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. In the end of the day, they trip over their own tricks. I refer you back to that verse where Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهِ. They plan and Allah plans. But if you stick to what Allah wants you to do, like the mother of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam stuck to what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wanted her to do, Allah not only delivered on His promise, Allah gave more. Allah not only united her with her son, Allah then made her breastfeed the child. Allah made her get a job in the palace. Yes, she had reliance. She had a plan B. A plan B doesn't mean you don't have reliance. After she dropped him in the basket into the river Nile, she let her daughter walk at a distance to observe what will happen. So, you know, as a mother, at least she knows, because not knowing can kill a person, you know. That's why sometimes when people go missing, you hear the parents say, as much as we would like them to be alive, but if they are not going to be alive, we'd rather see the body than not knowing. Because not knowing, that uncertainty just finishes you up. So the system of Allah works very differently. Sometimes we become very despondent. Sometimes we, waliyadu billah, we say things which are dangerous for our iman. When is Allah going to show us victory? Why is it like this? Listen, in the end, we need to understand that our intelligence is limited. Our intellect is restricted. As much as compared to the other creations of Allah, we stand tall in terms of our intelligence, in terms of our acumen, but compared to Allah, we're nothing. We're like a speck of dust in the entire desert. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, from the palace of kufr, He took out the nur of nubuwa. You know, they say Samiri, it's not part of what we discussed, but Samiri, the story of Samiri is well known. It comes later on, where he was the one who tricked the Banu Israel into worshipping the calf. They say Samiri, he was brought up by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Yet he ended up being a disbeliever in Allah. And Musa alayhi salam, who was brought up by Pharaoh, became a Nabi, and he was the same person who then brought Pharaoh to his knees. He was the same person that ensured that Pharaoh and his kingdom came to an end. So let's not become despondent. Obviously, we don't wait. I've mentioned this, you know. People like to listen to all these talks that are apocalyptic in nature. They listen about Dajjal. Obviously, Dajjal is a reality. But they only want to listen about Dajjal because they're hoping now that Dajjal must come. So Isa alayhi salam would come and then the issue will just get resolved. They want to know when Imam Mahdi is coming. There are all these discussions about whether, before you used to hear that he's going to come in 2004, but 2004 has long come and gone. So people get really caught up in all these discussions about Qiyamah and Dajjal and this and that. Obviously, these are authentic and entrenched things in our deen. But we sometimes are looking for these things as an escape mechanism. Okay, so I don't need to do anything. I'll wait for Imam Mahdi. I don't need to do anything because the Rockefellers and the Rothschilds and the New World Order, they're running the world. I'm not for a moment suggesting that there aren't forces, whoever those forces may be, that control things from behind the scenes. And that some of these conspiracy theories and reality, accurate theories, I'm not denying that. But what I'm saying is that why allow yourself to become so despondent that you become defeatist? You become totally despondent that, okay, everybody else is running the world. I got no say in the matter. They're observing my every move via my cell phone and they know everything and they're countering everything and they got a 500-year plan and I don't even have a 5-day plan. And shaitan sometimes makes us, we mustn't be naive. We mustn't think that just by working day by day and by being sincere that everything will fall into place. No, you have to work. You know, you have to have a plan. You have to understand how things work. You have to be alert. You have to be intelligent and shrewd. And there's a degree of cunning also that's required. But in the end of the day, do not become defeatist. It's not a case of just throwing up your hands and saying, well, now, you know, there's nothing more that I can do. I only have to wait for Imam Mahdi. That's actually a sign of the weakness of faith. Whilst Imam Mahdi will come, when he comes, he's got his job to do right now. You've got your job to do. So are you doing your job? Are you making an effort? Allah will not judge you on results. No, never. There were many Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, the hadith mentions on the day of Qiyamah, they will come with just a handful of followers. Will Allah judge them and say, well, you know, so few people followed? You know, results are in the hands of Allah. Allah will judge you on your effort. Allah will judge you in terms of you doing what you needed to do. So that's something that that we need to keep in mind. We go for a quick break. When we come back, we move into the last segment of the program. There are just two or three more lessons that I want to touch on before we wrap up the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and the lessons that we derive from it. Welcome back. We move into the final segment of the program and we're talking about lessons from the life of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Just to pick up from what I mentioned before the break, the next lesson I want to focus on is Musa alayhi salatu wasalam played his part. He knew that he would need a miracle to be able to bring the Pharaoh to his knees. He knew that. He knew that the miracle would come. He kind of got the impression, he already got the indication from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala that miracle would come. But notwithstanding the fact that he knew that he had to wait for that miracle to come. He didn't just sit back and relax and say, oh Allah, send the miracle, oh Allah, send the miracle, oh Allah, it's getting worse, oh Allah, it's getting worse. No, he did what he needed to do. He went to the Pharaoh. He tried to explain to him. When Pharaoh put up the magicians, he defeated the magicians. When Pharaoh said, okay, supplicate and make dua to your Allah, you know, after those different punishments that came, the frogs and the blood and the locusts and whatever else, he did it. He was actively involved. He constantly tried. He tried to make an improvement. Now, today we talk so pessimistically about conditions, and I can understand why we are pessimistic spiritually and physically, you know, the kind of turmoil that we are in. But we can't drop the ball. We cannot lose courage. We need to continue. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam did not wait for a miracle. You know, miracles, we believe in it. The help of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will come, but you cannot just sit back and say, Mata Nasrullah, when the help of Allah will come. Ala inna Nasrullahi qareeb. That the help of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is indeed very, very close. But continue. Make an effort every single day. Get up. Yes, it doesn't mean that you must become monotonous or you must become very routine-like, or you must, if you're failing, you must do the same things, do the same thing over and over again, expect different results. Strategizing is part of playing your part. Amending your strategy, adapting your strategy, changing your strategy, it's part of playing your part. So do it, but be focused, be involved, be there in the trenches, try and make a difference. Let it not be that you just sit back and become a couch critic, you know. You become one of those people who's got the world of opinions, who can talk, chun and chun, as they say, but you can't do. You can talk the talk, but you cannot, or very rarely can you walk the talk. So play your part. Also, what we need to understand is that change is now. Change is now. You cannot defer change. You cannot say that change will come at some other time. Remember that no matter how long you live, and how long can we live? 65 is the average age. These days, I read an article the other week, and they say that even though the life expectancy now and the average life is longer than, say, in the early 1900s when you had different kinds of diseases and you had measles and you had polio and you had what. And there, you know, people would live on average till the age of about 45, and that's it. Now they say even if you live, you're not going to live much more than 100, 110, 120. Beyond that, I mean, then it's Guinness Book of Records time, and you're one in a couple of billion. And very few people are going to be that one in a very couple of billion. Now Pharaoh, he thought that it would never come to an end. He thought it would never come to an end, even though, I mean, people were dying in front of him, even though deep down he knew one day he's going to die. And now when he sees the punishment coming, he says, "Amantu annahu la ilaha illa alladhi amanat bihi banu Israel." I bring iman that there is none worthy of worship except that being in whom the Banu Israel have brought iman. You see, arrogance, even in his final moments when he can see the punishment now and he can see the angels descending, he cannot bring himself to take the name of Allah. A person who cannot take the name of Allah, a person who is deprived of the sweetness of the name of Allah, a person who is deprived of love of Allah being in his heart, that person is truly, truly, truly deprived. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala protect us. So Abu Jahl also in his final moments, he was proud. Cut my neck here, closer to the chest. So when all the decapitated heads are put together, my head will stand a bit tall. People can point and say, that's the head of Abu Jahl, the leader of the Quraysh. Pharaoh, you know, I bring iman, but in that being in whom the Banu Israel bring iman. But Allah says in the verses of the Quran, Al-An, now? See, Allah is very tolerant. Allah gives you a lot of respite, but there has to be a cut of time. And now when you see the angels of punishment, who won't bring iman? Then it's too late, and that's when he brought iman. Now you and I, we don't know, death can be around the corner. How many times don't we hear, I mean, he was sitting here and talking to us, and next minute, there was this clip that was doing the rounds, and I clicked on it, I didn't know what it was about. I don't know how, you know, appropriate it is to send these clips around. It was of a scholar who was giving a talk, and he's 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 speaking. And next minute, his speech starts slurring a little, and his head just drops. And when they go and see what, they realize the man is gone. He's sitting there in front of a big crowd of people, and he's talking and talking and talking. And next minute, his head just drops. Now, we know about Moulana Qasim Ali from Benoni, right? He gave the Jummah talk and just took a moment there. He wasn't feeling too nice, and next minute, he's gone. On a Friday in the masjid at such a blessed time, in such a blessed place, in such a blessed way. But how will we go? You know, some people are fortunate in many ways that's why we make this dua to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min mawtil fuja'ah. That, oh Allah, we seek your refuge from a sudden death, because a sudden death doesn't allow you the time to prepare yourself, to clean the slate and to seek pardon and to ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to forgive you. It doesn't allow you that opportunity. And sickness and you know, old age, even though you're going through a particular tough period, but it allows you to put your affairs in place. So you must always make this dua, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min mawtil fuja'a, that, oh Allah, I seek your protection from a sudden death, from a sudden death. So what we need to understand is that the time to change is now. We cannot delay. We can't wait for the end of the year. We can't wait for Ramadan. We can't wait for Hajj. We can't say, okay. I've mentioned this many times. The devil, when it comes to believers, he just uses procrastination. No Muslim will say, I won't perform Salah, waliyadu billah. No, just now make it. Just now. Until the time lapses, then it becomes a routine in your life. And then, you know, a few days go and you don't even perform one Salah. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala protect us, and may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala assist us. So the lessons that we learn from these stories in the Quran, and so, you know, we just scrape the surface. The idea behind this is to inspire one and all that pick up the authentic books and listen to the reliable scholars and learn for yourself. Learn more. We can never be old or too old to learn. We can never be too educated to learn. We can never be too knowledgeable to learn. Learn and learn and learn more and take lesson from it. Take lesson from it. You see, I heard something the other day. They say knowledge is like water. Water, as long as it flows, I mean, there's no limit to what it can do. The fish will be there. It will water the gardens, trees will grow, plants will grow, and a lot of benefits will accrue from that flowing water. But let the water stagnate, then it becomes just one stinking mess, right? Doesn't it? So what we need to understand, really what we need to understand, is that the time to change is now. We listen to lectures, we listen to discourses, we listen to We read books, we read articles, we come across clips, all of those kind of things. But how much is it bringing me closer to Allah? How much is it bringing me closer to a change in my life? How much is it bringing me closer to actual transformation? That's what we need to start asking ourselves. In the end, we can discuss all of these stories from the Quran. In the end, we can talk about all of these lessons and people can sit back and say, wow, that's a unique perspective. I never heard this before. Wonderful research. Oh, wonderful point. Oh, wow, you know, the way it was so gripping and it was so captivating. Fine. All of that on its place. All of that on its place. But in the end, did it bring you closer to Allah? Did it inspire you to start, changing your life? Did it make you think about harder than translated into some sort of action? Those are all the things that we need to keep in mind. Those are all the things that we need to be cognizant of. Those are all the things that we need to internalize when we talk about these lessons that we learn from the seerah and the sunnah of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. So yes, as I said in the beginning, the month of Muharram is now going to leave us. And already 1 month of the Hijri year 1438 is gone. Again, I'm saying the caravan of life continues. It waits for nobody. Big people pass away, prominent people pass away, pious people pass away. Yeah, a few tears are shed, a few remarks are made. There's a little bit of longing, and then life moves on. Life moves on. You lose your wife, after a while you marry another woman. You lose your husband, after a while you marry another man. You lose your parents, well, you won't get new other parents, but life just carries on. You forget about them after a while. Then the child will be told and rebuked that, you know, when last did you go to the graveyard to visit your father's grave? When last did you make Isali Thawab? That's the nature of life. In the end, it's nafsi, nafsi. Everyone for himself. Everyone for herself. Everyone for himself and God for all, as they say. So let us establish the relationship with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. People will make you happy one day, they'll make you sad the next day. They'll elevate you one day, they'll disappoint you the next day. And like that, you go up and down, up and down, up and down. But in the end of the day, focus on Allah. Nurture your relationship with Allah. Uphold your ta'alluq and maintain and sustain and nourish that relationship with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And once you do all of that, then you will understand that it will bring you happiness, it will bring you solace, it will bring you contentment, it will bring you satisfaction, not only in the year after, but in this world as well. We need to learn those lessons, we need to internalize those lessons, we need to build the courage to become better Muslims. Courage is one thing, you know, the scholars have written, the more you use it, the stronger it becomes. Other things in life, the more you use it, the more it diminishes, the more it kind of weakens. No. Courage, the more you use it, the stronger it becomes. The more you use it, the more it becomes of benefit to you. Okay, so that's it for this week. Jazakumullah for tuning in. As always, the pleasure is ours. Keep the dial on channel 347 ITV. There's many different programs that you can benefit from. We always ask, but very few people communicate. But nonetheless, communicate with us. Let us know via social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever you prefer. Let us know what are your thoughts on the program, on the discussion, some suggestions in terms of topics. Until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أضحابه الحق بالخذلان مدفونا فبالجهاد بنى الإسلام قوته وهل لغير قوي الناس يصغونا رباه هيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا فأنت من بالتقى والدين يهدينا أدعوك يا أمتي فاستنهضي همما فالمسجد الأقصى ما زال يدعونا ندي على الفتية الأحرار.